says Pope Francis, Sunday should be observed by all. Notice that title right below the lady that is giving Fox News. Notice, weekend worker woes. Oh, and now Pope Francis wants you to close your business on Sunday so that you can worship their pagan sun worship day, S-U-N-Day. This video is coming from Sunday churches. What? You're gonna sit in this porn sexual churches with your children? You want Christ in you, the hope of glory that the Bible says, or you want the devil in you, the hope of demons? The word Protestant simply means Protestants. Sunday churches, they are forefathers. They used to protest against Roman Catholic Church. They are false doctrine during dark ages. But unfortunately, Vatican II, 1960s, was the time the Roman Catholic, they plan how they can destroy Reformation or bring all the Sunday churches back to them, because Revelation chapter 17 says Roman Catholic Church is the mother of harlot. If this church is mother of harlot, it means that this church has a daughters. So they infiltrate all the Sunday churches. This is the way they decide to destroy Sunday churches. They decide to bring false music and sexual dance in Sunday churches. I can't believe these people can go so far like this.
A lady who's singing Jennifer Hudson's song, and it's so bad that she cusses in church.
I'm not living without you. I don't wanna be free. I'm staying in you, and you, and you, you're gonna love me.
And now she's cursing the church? She just cursing the church. Wow, who make her curse? The devil, because she's singing for the devil. That's why she's cursing, says the word of God. The abundance of the heart is what the mouth speak. Watch this.
When I read in the Bible where he says, I am, I just smile and say, yes, I am too.
Your God, I am a little girl. I am.
Jesus is the one who told Moses at the burning bush, he says, I am that I am. So in New Testament, when Jesus Christ came, he says, I am. But unfortunately, these satanic pastors, they believe they God, so they also says, I am. Wow.
When I read in the Bible where he says, I am, I just smile and say, yes, I am too.
That you're gods. I am a little God. I am a little.
Revelation 16, 13 to 14. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the mouth of dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of false prophet. For they are the spirit of devils, working miracles which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Watch this.
I'm not a witch. I'm a witch for Jesus.
You are what? You are a foul devil. Do you know who you are talking to? Foul devil.
Where's the five fingers? Say to the face.
What?
Slap.
I'm not for violence against women. And he smacked the mess out of her. And all she did was she just fixed her team natural hair. And she took it like.
I'm not a witch.
Who are you?
But I'm witch for Jesus.
Jesus has no witches. You are a devil. You are not set for deliverance. And you are free to go to hell.
That's the coldest line ever. You are free to go to hell. Like, he didn't try to call the demon out. He didn't try to pray for her. He smacked her and then told her to go to hell. What is she supposed to get delivered for?
He's speaking a false tongue that Revelation 16 verse 13 to 14 says, and then he cursing the church.
Det er fede. Kom, klar, man fangler mig, han. Am echte skabke. Bol bom i det meje, be bom at don so bo bo. Bol bom i det meje, be bom at don so bo bo.
All these Roman Catholic Church pastors that are infiltrating Sunday churches secretly, they destroy Sunday churches, they make fun about Jesus Christ, and then they make fun about Sunday churches. Notice what the Word of God says in Isaiah chapter 28, verse 14 to 15. Notice. Wherefore hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men that rule this people which is in Jerusalem. Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death and with hell, are we at agreement? When the overflowing scorn shall pass through, it shall not come to us, for we have made lies our refuge, and on the falsehood have we hid ourselves. Now Jesus applied to this false shepherd. Isaiah 28 verse 18. Notice what Jesus says. And your covenant with dead shall be disnewed, and your agreement with her shall not stand. When the overflowing scorn shall pass through, then you shall be trodden down by it.
Woo! Pretty a fella, many in Socorro Day.
Now be sure to get this straight.
Something. Wait till they come to Boston. Toronto.
Leave us to ourselves. Don't leave us to our foolish thinking. Lord, we want all that you have. All that you have.
Yes.
We thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Watch this.
Contrary to that highly publicized prediction, the world did not end over the weekend, which means a number of preachers who live like rock stars will get to continue living the good life. How good? Here's Lisa Guerrero and the iSquad with a look at some who've been preaching prosperity who are living large.
Fresh wind! Fresh!
They are some of the most popular TV preachers in the country.
We're family here!
They urge the faithful followers to donate generously, and in return, the Lord will bring them prosperity.
I'm not going to be going to heaven and be broke when I get there.
And there's no denying some people have prospered handsomely.
Wow!
The pastors themselves. They live like rock stars with huge mansions, private jets, and fancy cars. Their lifestyles are so lavish, six of them have been investigated by the U.S. Senate. Like Paula White, who lives in multi-million dollar homes in New York City and Tampa, Florida. And Creflo Dollar, he gets around in style, flying in private jets to preach around the country. He owns this mansion in an exclusive Atlanta suburb.
Mr. Dollar, how do you...
Not one of them would agree to an interview about their opulent lifestyle.
How did you justify your million-dollar mansions in
your jets to all of your donors, sir.
Oh, yeah.
But when it comes to opulence, few religious leaders compare to Kenneth Copeland.
You and I are supposed to always have.
To show you his house, we rented his helicopter so you can see his 18,000 square foot mansion valued at over $6 million.
He lives in this home outside Fort Worth, Texas. It has beautiful water views and comes complete with a boathouse. But that's not all. Copeland is an avid pilot, and here's his pride and joy, a $20 million Cessna Citation jet. It's the fastest private jet money can buy. He said he needed it to better serve the Lord, and proudly did a flyby for his followers after the church bought it.
Shout amen!
But it's not just one plane. We found a fleet of planes registered to the church, and you won't catch him waiting in line at the airport, because he's got his own, the Kenneth Copeland Airport, located right next to his mansion.
I think Copeland is unbelievably greedy.
Ole Anthony heads the Trinity Foundation, a religious watchdog group that worked closely with the Senate committee investigating Copeland and other TBB preachers.
Televangelism alone is at least a $2.5 to $3 billion industry. Untaxed, unregulated.
That's right. By law, religious groups like Copeland's are exempt from federal taxes, and they don't have to report how they spend their money to anyone.
Amen.
Copeland's church takes in tens of millions a year through donations and selling books and DVDs to his donors.
She sent them a lot of money, a whole lot of money.
When Christy Parker's mother died of cancer, she found diaries that showed her mother sent Copeland most of her life savings, hoping her faith and donations would cure her of her terminal disease.
What do you think of Kenneth Copeland's lifestyle?
TV doesn't do it justice. Their office furniture is probably worth more than most people's houses. It makes you sick.
Oh my.
Copeland refused our request for an interview, so we caught up with him at an event in North Carolina.
Why you're living such a lifestyle of luxury off of church donations?
Ma'am, I don't think we have time for this.
Thank you.
Why won't you answer our questions?
A hotel employee tried to prevent us from taping.
Wait. Hold on.
Come here.
It's just a simple question, sir.
Yes, and I'm going to give you a simple answer.
Thank you.
My lifestyle follows the scripture. We give, we believe, we're open.
You have a fleet of private jets. Why is that necessary? You're a minister. How many private jets do you have?
That is none of your business.
Right after that, he walked away.
Although Copeland says he cooperated with the Senate investigation, the Senate committee disagreed, saying only two television preachers did, Joyce Myers and Benny Hinn. And the committee recommended that the IRS investigate further.
They set up new world order so that they can control the world and bring everybody on the Roman Catholic Church.
The affirmative task we have now is to create a new world order.
Now we can see a new world coming into view. A world in which there is the very real prospect of a new world order.
But I often use myself that we needed a new world order.
Pope Benedict XVI is calling for a new world financial order in the third encyclical of his pontificate,
Globalized Economy. The document was released just hours before the G8 summit.
So notice.
I did, your old country.
Yes.
And it was successful.
Successful?
You have some decisions. It's not so easy in this process.
Now, Roman Catholic Church leaders or papacy are controlling every president and Sunday pastors around the world. So now they're pushing a gay agenda in churches and outside the church. Leviticus 18:22. Thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is abomination. Jude 1:7. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the city about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Watch this.
When President Obama came out in support of gay marriage, we announced it, we celebrated it, we applauded it in this congregation, because we have spent years trying to teach this congregation that God loves everybody.
Here is news from the Vatican tonight, widely described today as something of an earthquake for the Catholic Church. It involves a global gathering of bishops, including the Pope, held behind closed doors, and what could be a dramatic shift in the church's thinking on the acceptance of gays, and separately, how to minister to divorced and remarried Catholics.
The Francis Effect and his vision of a more inclusive church embraced today by the Catholic bishops. In a statement, one observer describes as the church thinking out loud, the bishops take a new merciful tone to disaffected Catholics, writing, homosexuals have gifts and qualities to offer to the Christian communities. Last year, famously saying about a gay person,
chi sono io per giudicarla?
Who am I to judge?
In an unprecedented show of openness to the real lives of many Catholics today, a Vatican document released Monday said gays should be accepted, and there are positive aspects to a couple living together without being married.
Homosexuals have gifts and qualities to offer the Christian community. Are we capable of welcoming these people, guaranteeing to them a fraternal space in our communities?
We must respect the dignity of every person. And the fact to be homosexual doesn't mean that this dignity must be not recognized and promoted.
For heterosexuals, the bishop said civil weddings and cohabitation should be accepted with the aim of helping the couple commit eventually to a church wedding. Bishops clearly took into account the views of Pope Francis, who has urged a new tone of welcome for the church.
The question is this an example of Pope Francis trying to take the church in new directions, open it up, without changing or assaulting doctrine?
Yeah, that's a good way to put it, Charlie. I'd say you're on to something. Of the Holy Father's attempt to present the teaching of the church in a fresh, exciting, enchanting new way. There's unanimity there, Charlie.
Cardinal, this report, which was written by a committee handpicked by Pope Francis, I've read through it. It's 11 pages, and I want to go specifically to the parts that have become so controversial. There is a section that says, welcoming homosexual persons, and it says this: homosexuals have gifts and qualities to offer the Christian community.
On the eve of the next Supreme Court term, the annual Red Mass held in Washington today, the Catholic service is held to bless those responsible for the administration of justice. It dates back to the Middle Ages. It's called the Red Mass because of the color of the garment once worn by judges. Supreme Court members have been attending the Red Mass here in Washington for decades.
Another possible step for the Pope may be the UN General Assembly, just up I-95 in New York. There, Archbishop Cardinal Timothy Dolan has been publicly angling for a Big Apple papal visit. It just so happens the trip will coincide with the annual meeting of world leaders. But the Philly visit will be a big boon for the Latino Catholics, who have propelled the church's growth in the U.S.
I think he brings something to the table as a Latin American pope that others may not have brought.
We want to be on record that the NAACP now firmly opposes all efforts to restrict marriage equality. Civil marriage, like all civil rights provided by the government, must be provided equally to all.
And like, it's crazy because like a lot of these pastors, especially in the black churches, like they get up and they just talk about like gay people and how gay people are wrong and bad. And half of them are gay themselves, you know?
I said that in jest, but that's
no, but
an
that's
underlying.
That's interesting. That's
fine. Yeah, we don't do weird stuff. Now, the other hypocritical aspect of that is our churches, Kira, are filled with same gender loving people, from the music department to the pulpits. Black music, church music, where would it be without our same gender loving or gay musicians and singers? Not all of them are.
that many of have come to you and said can't come
out.
Oh,
yes. Oh,
and
yeah.
We're talking very powerful people
yes,
in the gospel
ma'am.
Industry.
Yes,
I've met
ma'am.
Them.
Yes, ma'am. With tears in their eyes, they were afraid. There are people who come to me and say, I embrace your gospel of inclusion, Bishop, but I can't. It's not a theological issue with me. It's a business decision. I'll lose my flock. I'll lose my money. I'll lose my parsons. I'll lose myself. I can't love everybody. I can't even love me, he could say. And I want to say to that group, and this is a wake-up call. Until the church, black or otherwise, confronts, not combats, confronts this issue of human sexuality and homosexuality, which is not going away. Homosexuals and homosexuality going away. If every gay person in our churches left, or those who have an orientation or a preference or an inclination or fantasy, if everyone left, we wouldn't have a church.
That's interesting.
Or fantasy. If everyone left, we wouldn't have a church.
That's interesting.
Yeah, there are gay doctors, police officers, attorneys. Look at the whole Catholic Church.
About gays in the church. Your take on gays in the church, should they be allowed? Of course, it might seem like an easy answer. And if so, should gays be able to participate in the worship service? Pastor Dog.
Yes.
Yes, to what question?
They should. They are. It's not. they should be allowed. Jesus, again, he says, whosoever will, let him come.
I'm sorry. Should they be allowed to come, or should they be allowed to participate in the worship service?
They participate in worship service now. Participating in church, it's from the back door to the front door. It's nothing new, but it's existing now. I mean, every church, but every church I've been to.
Hello, guys. What is going on in the Presbyterian Church? It's become the Lesbyterian Church of the USA. These two women, Reverend Casey Clark Porter and the Reverend Holly Clark Porter, were co-ordained last week as joint ministers in the Presbyterian Church of the USA. And they are married to each other. The sad thing is, these two young women, one of them still in her 20s, they were married to men and they divorced their husbands after meeting each other in the seminary, in the Presbyterian Bible School. And only a few short days after the Presbyterian Church changing its constitution to allow same-sex marriage, these guys, well, girls, who have been married for some time, are now both pastors, ministers in the so-called church, the Lesbyterian, Presbylesbian Church. This is trampling the blood of Jesus underfoot. Here they are administering communion. I mean, this breaks my heart. Even their own wedding photographs show you that deep down they believe there ought to be one male and one female in a marriage. Otherwise, they wouldn't be dressed as a man and a woman. One is the assistant minister at that church, and the other is a minister at a church called the Big Gay Church.
I've been in ministry, and I've been in the church where we had homosexuals serving in ministry, and it wasn't a problem for our pastors. I mean, if we had that kind of thing happening in church, we wouldn't have nobody serving in leadership.
Says Jesus, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrite, for ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. Ye neither go in yourself, neither suffer them that are entering to go in. Watch this.
This is the fifth time that a pope has visited the United Nations. to the exercise of power.
Una
the citizens of all the nations represented in this hall.
Peter
says, is in reaffirming the importance which the Catholic Church attaches to this institution and the hope which she places in its activities.
Holy Father, welcome to the White House. So on behalf of the American people, it is my great honor and privilege to welcome you to the United States of America. Your Holiness, you've been celebrated as the first Pope from the Americas. This is your first visit to the United States. And you are also the first pontiff to share an encyclical through a Twitter account. Holy Father, your visit not only allows us in some small way to reciprocate the extraordinary hospitality that you extended to me at the Vatican last year. It also reveals how much all Americans, from every background and every faith, value the role that the Catholic Church plays in strengthening America. From my time working in impoverished neighborhoods with the Catholic Church in Chicago, to my travels as president, I have seen firsthand how every single day Catholic communities, priests, nuns, laity, and just as the church has stood with those struggling to break the chains of poverty, you call on all of us, Catholic.
Mr. Speaker, the Pope of the Holy See.
Mr. Vice President,
Mr. Speaker,
I am most grateful for your invitation to address this joint session of Congress in the land of the free at the home of the brave. On the other, the figure of Moses leads us directly to God.
But look at this next video. This pastor is the one with the microphone, okay? She said, you got something to say. This is what he has to say. Now pay close attention. I'm gonna let the whole thing play through and then we'll talk about it.
Rest of these 7 days that she's here, any of you that come and any of our friends that come, we need to be deeply respectful. We need to show an intense love to them. But above all of those things, we need to spend all of our time at the deepest place of prayer, praying that God indeed would protect all those who hear this false message that comes from her lips. Because God's message is not miracles, but that the shed blood of Jesus Christ would cleanse humble sinners. And when miracles are emphasized, Jesus is denied.
Sir. Okay, guess what? Go, I didn't say it, they did. You all heard the words that he spoke. You are removed from my tent. No, not to come to my church. No, 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 no. No, 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 don't touch him. Don't touch him. Don't touch him. Please be removed from my tent.
I like the way this pastor exposed her false messages. Now she's going to cast him out from the church, says the Apostle Paul. Have I then become your enemy? Because I tell you the truth. Isaiah 66 verse 5, hear the word of the Lord, ye that tremble at his word. Your brethren that hate you, that cast you out for my name's sake, says, let the Lord be glorified, but he shall appear to your joy, and they shall be ashamed.
Your engine is not revving up. You know what you need? You need a Holy Ghost enema right up your rear end.
Benny Hinn's wife also cursing the church. I told you, said Jesus, abundance of the heart is what the mouth speak.
If your engine is not revving up, you know what you need? You need a Holy Ghost enema right up your rear end.
Matthew 7 verse 15 to 18. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. You shall know them by their fruit. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. This pastor is telling their listeners to not go on their knees and pray to Jesus Christ by faith, but he's telling his members to put their hand on their magic healing TV.
Draw a little closer. Put your hands out toward your television screen.
Your Holiness, on behalf of all of us gathered here today, indeed on behalf of all the people of our beloved nation, we welcome you back to America.
We're here at Blessed Sacrament Parish, we are Change LA, to meet someone who has been nicknamed the Black Pope. He's actually the Jesuit General, and his name is Very Reverend Adolfo Nicholas S.J. We're here to say hi and talk to him about his nickname and his extreme oath of the Jesuits.
You just came out of a campaign, election, and the inauguration of a new president. We have been exposed to 1 year and a half of words and words and words, or even religious words, because also religious words have been manipulated. I am so happy we have a financial crisis.
Hello, I really, really enjoyed your service. Thank you so much. I had a couple of questions. I was wondering if you could clear something up for me.
Maybe later, because
just really quick. Why do they call you the Black Pope?
Oh, that started in the 19th century.
Did it really?
Yeah, but I don't like it because
no.
It's in terms of power. No,
yeah.
So the general, the Jesuits had a lot of power, but he was black, so Black Pope.
Oh, maybe.
I'm not Pope, and you don't have no power.
And I see that there's a lot of liberal symbols here. One of the things in your Jesuit high oath, I think it is, it says something about, furthermore, you promise to declare that you'll, at the first opportunity, seek war, at any opportunity against heretics, Protestants, liberals. See here? And that you will spare neither age nor sex nor condition, and I will hang, waste, boil, flays. You've never seen this before?
No, never seen it.
Strangle, bury alive, and it's horrible. And I was like, look, it's in the congressional record. But he was very confused. He'd never seen it before. I told him it was in the congressional record. He said that he might talk to me later about it, but there's a big line. So do we want to wait and talk to him later about it? Just so that you know what I was asking him. I furthermore promise and declare that I will, when opportunity presents, to make wage relentless war, secretly or openly, against all heretics, Protestants, and liberals, as I am directed to extirpate and exterminate them from the face of the whole earth, and that I will spare neither age, sex, or condition, and that I will hang, waste, boil, flay, strangle, and bury alive these infamous heretics, rip up the stomachs and wombs of their women, and crush their infants' heads against the walls in order to annihilate forever the execrable race. And then it goes on to say some other stuff. But you can look this up. It's on the internet. I just want to read this on camera real quick. Just trying to find a private moment. He said that I could talk to him afterwards.
Okay,
when the line was not too busy.
You need to go outside with all that.
Okay.
Because right now he's not going to read nothing because he's going to go somewhere else.
Oh.
So thank you.
Do you think we were bothering you?
I think so. With your letter.
Okay.
We can't have that. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry. I was just trying to clear something up.
I know. But this.
And the enemy commanded me to light a candle and to place my right palm on the frame. I mean, they can deliver. You go there, you tell them what they want, they tell you what to do, and you get results.
T.D. Joshua's watching famous private plays during his satanic, abominable, devilish, unclean, unholy, demonic, all-called, so-called miracle. And the church members don't know how to bark. Look how they all sitting down. Now barking, says the word of God. His watchmen are blind. They are all ignorant. They are dumb dog. They cannot bark. Sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Ephesians 5:11 says, and have no fellowship with unfruitful work of darkness, but rather reprove them. All these pastors use occult satanic power.
The wife of one of the country's multi-millionaire pastors, Pastor Chris Oyakhilome, has filed for divorce.
The wife is seeking divorce on the grounds of unreasonable behavior and adultery.
Three points. Three beautiful points. Number one, that's wonderful. What I've...
No, none of that stuff is really interesting.
Is there a bra in the house? Is there a bra? Oh, they didn't perk. That's almost percolating. That's almost percolating. Look, there's panties all over the place. I see boy shorts. I shouldn't be thinking about this right now. I should be able to interpret the word and the message, not be thinking about, you got boy shorts on. Mother's bored. What are y'all doing? Y'all are talking, y'all are whispering, but y'all ain't drop kicking nobody. Okay, no bras back on. Oh man, I feel weird. Somebody should, where are the ushers with the blankets? There ain't no usher to blanket this. See, there's her booty again. Wow, she almost broke her neck. All up in her drawers, all up in her drawers. Look at this. Standing, oh, the mother's board with the white ass, standing ovation. Where's the covering?
Notice what Ellen G. White says in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 136, paragraph 2. To stand in defense of truth and righteousness when a majority forsake us, to fight a battle of the Lord when champions are few, this will be our great test. At that time, we must gather warmth from the coldness of others, courage from their cowardice, and loyalty from their treason. The nation will be on the side of the great rebel leader. God says those we're going to protest, or we're going to stand for the truth in these last days. The word of God is clear that we don't have to use harsh or cutting words. Let the word of God do the cutting and rebuking. That's what Ellen G. White, pen of inspiration, says. So says the Apostle Paul. Foolish Galatians, who bewitch you not to believe the truth. Jesus Christ is the one who died for the whole world, and he's drawn everybody to himself. But this power, they don't want you to go to Jesus Christ. They want you to go to them and confess your sin to them. So notice what Revelation chapter 18 says. And they also infiltrate the kings, presidents. So notice. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen and is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the whole of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of her fornications. And notice, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. And the merchant of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. Notice what it says in verse 4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sin, that you receive not her plagues. For her sin has reached unto heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. God is calling you to come out of all this abominable fallen Babylon satanic churches.
When a Catholic Jesuit learns Sunday churches, their doctrine, and they draw all their churches to so-called the mother of the church, because they know their doctrine and they can answer questions and preach. So the members of the Sunday churches, they think that all the pastors are faithful pastors. So now it's all about my pastor says, my pastor says, my pastor says. And this is the crying that a lot of times you hear from them. Instead of them to study to show thyself approved, just like Bible says, they're making flesh their right arm. And some of them, when they learn the Sabbath truth, that is always Saturday, because their pastors has been hypnotized them for so many years. So when they go and they talk to their pastors, instead of them to talk to God and make decision based on that says the Lord, they make their pastors make decision for them, because that's how bad they hypnotize them.
They come right out and state exactly how they infiltrate any religious group they want. They'll come in pretending to be a Pentecostal, pretending to be a Baptist, taking the leadership role and then completely subverting it from the inside.
Watch this.
Holiness, may I present Archbishop Cao Yang Barsamian, Primate of the Eastern Diocese of the Armenian Church in America.
According to ecumenical protocol, the Eastern Orthodox would be first in the Catholic Church's ecumenical responsibility.
The legate and ecumenical officer of the Eastern Diocese of the Armenian Church in America and president of the National Council of Churches in the United States. Holiness, may I present Reverend Dr. Donald McCoy, representing the presiding Bishop Mark Hansen of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Holiness, may I present Bishop Jeremiah J. Park, Bishop of the New York Annual Conference of the United Methodist Church. Your Holiness, may I present Reverend Wesley Granberg Michelson, the General Secretary of the Reformed Church in America. Your Holiness, may I present Reverend Dr. Clifton Kirkpatrick, the stated clerk of the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church in the United States. Your Holiness, may I present Reverend Dr. William J. Shaw, President of the National Baptist Convention, United States. Your Holiness, may I present Bishop James Leggett, General Superintendent of the International Pentecost Holiness Church. Your Holiness, may I present Dr. Leith Anderson, President of the National Association of Evangelicals. Your Holiness, may I present Bishop David H. Benke, President of the Atlantic District of the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod. Your Holiness, may I present Reverend Dr. A.R. Bernard Sr., President of the Council of Churches of the City of New York.
You understand the language, Your Holiness, and this is how they call this power. He think he is God. That's what their teachings is all about. Friends, religious leaders, when they come to meet this power, they wearing black, notice, dark color. They represent as sinners, and he represent God. And now listen to what Bible says. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. This is the chapter the Protestant Sunday churches, their forefathers, they used to protest against this power during dark ages, and they call them Antichrist. Notice Antichrist, but now you don't hear from Sunday churches anymore, because they betray their forefathers. Let's start from verse 3. Notice 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, all that is worshipped, so that he sit as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. Notice what it says in verse 7. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work.
Pope Francis met with the ecumenical and interreligious delegates March 20th, who had attended his inaugural Mass the day before. The representatives included Christian, Jewish, Muslim, Buddhist, Hindu, Sikh, and Jain leaders. Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew of Constantinople also had a private meeting with the new pope.
A church service is interrupted by a heated dispute over money. The fight over church leadership and finances at St. Michael Baptist Church in LaPlace was captured on video and posted to YouTube.
And WDSU reporter Gina Swanson is on your side with why the house of worship has now become a house divided.
It's a scene you don't expect to see at a Sunday church service, a fight in the pulpit.
It's a disgrace. It's uncalled for.
And yelling in the sanctuary, all as hymns kept playing at St. Michael Baptist Church. This house of worship has become a house divided. Members say it's the result of a dispute that started with questions over the church's finances.
I think they have a lot of preachers using the church for personal gain.
We asked questions regarding finances, and it was told to us, take what I give you, or you don't like what I'm giving you, go back where you came from.
And for those who did raise concerns.
We can't fellowship like we want because we was put out of the church, myself with 49 other members.
Members have even taken the matter to court.
The judge put a board of trustee to be in charge, and he's just like ignored that.
I hate the song Drunk in Love at this point in my life. As soon as I hear it come on, I turn the radio off. Whatever I'm listening to, it goes off. So you can understand my angst when I got this praise team singing Drunk in Love video sent to me no less than 15 times today.
Thinking, I've been thinking about your goodness, how you carried me low when I was sinking. You never left me alone, so Jesus, I want you. Now, don't act like y'all know it. You never left me alone, so Jesus, I want you.
As if it couldn't get any worse, they have a rapper doing Jay-Z.
I said, Jesus is the truth. If I do say so myself, if I do say so myself, if I do say so myself. Hold up, we the best, the next arrest. I don't want to be the living in sin, but then again, it's our right to give them Christ. At the same time, we live them life. We the best.
Pastor instructs the members to throw their shoes at the devil.
Goodbye, 2008. Devil, you and your imp, huh? Have got to get out of here. I'm gonna kill you. Sleep to me, Satan. Ah, devil, I got something. Now I got to throw it to you. I got to let you know. For everything you did, for every trouble you caused.
Now I get it. You know, I'm all for the symbolism. But here's problem number one. The Bible says, okay, here it is, 2 Corinthians 10:4, one of my favorite scriptures, by the way. And it reads, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. What does that mean? It means you wouldn't use actual physical weapons against the devil. Now, mind you, real devil wouldn't be on a mannequin. And why are the weapons of our warfare not carnal? Because these people's aim is atrocious. Okay, let's just take a look at some of these people. They have the worst aim ever. You're supposed to throw your shoes at the devil. He's got the one guy who tries to hand him his shoe, and he's like, no, you gotta throw your own shoe. These people are missing the devil by a mile, okay? Miles. Now, you're not gonna get many chances. I mean, they've hit the cameraman with the shoes. They've hit everything but the devil. I mean, at the...
I'm also going to start with a mark of the beast that they already have in White House. So be more patient. And all they have to do is enforce their law. And the whole thing is combined with religion. The Bible says the mark of the beast means this power has a mark. The beast is a language that God is using for this power. And they themselves, they says in their own book, the book of Catechism, the old version, notice, they says Sunday worship is the mark of authority. The new version, they don't use the word authority, but at least, thank God, they still admit it. Even the new version of Catechism, they still says they changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. Friends, the mark of the beast is not worldly speculations that sometimes you hear. Some people says, well, it's computer chip. Unfortunately, you don't find in the Bible. And some people says, you know, it's 666. But according to Revelation 13 verse 18, actually 666 help you to find the beast. What I mean is to identify the beast. But the Bible says the mark. The reason why I repeat and I kind of stretch it, because I don't want you to miss it. It's a deception. Notice the mark of the beast. It's clear. It's not a mark that anybody can see. It's a spiritual mark, means they belong to the devil, means they have cast their allegiance, or they have given their allegiance to Pope, the Antichrist. Daniel chapter 7 verse 17 says, the four beasts which thou saw are the four kings who reign on the earth. Babylon is the first kingdom. Medo-Persia Empire was the second kingdom. And Greece, third kingdom. Rome, fourth kingdom. So when Revelation 13 verse 18 says, here is wisdom, let him who have understand calculate the number of the beast, is a number of a man. His number is 666. So according to Revelation 13 verse 18, 666 help you to identify the beast. Roman Catholic, Roman numerals, some of them have a value, some of them doesn't. But when you put all of them together, it end up to 666. Constantine changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. But unfortunately, Sunday churches, they adopt sun worship day for so many years. They don't want to get rid of it. But actually, it's a pagan sun worship day, Sunday worship. Look even the spellings, you'll find out. Matter of fact, if you look your calendar, Sunday is always begin as the first day of the week. Unfortunately, they will skip, and some people, they don't know, they will count Monday as the first day of the week, because according to Revelation chapter 12 verse 9, the devil will deceive the whole world. So it's a deception. So the devil, you know, he's in the process blinding the people, including the Christendom. Friends, if you go to church Sunday, notice the first day church, now you don't have the mark of the beast according to Revelation 14 and 13, unless the law is enforced. That's why now you hear different country, they try to forcing the people to not sell or do anything on Sunday, because they try to enforce the law. But according to Bible, notice, United States is the one who's going to cause the whole world to worship the beast. They are sun worship day, means Sunday worship, according to Revelation 13. So whenever United States enforce the law, then every country also going to enforce, because they control the whole world, every president on the Roman Catholic Church. We know according to history, Jesus Christ rose from the dead Sunday. So even his dead body, he kept the Sabbath. Just like the Bible says, all things was made by him. When he finished his work, the end of creation, according to Genesis chapter 2 verse 1 to 3, he kept the Sabbath. And also, when he finished his work of redemption, he says it is finished, and he kept the Sabbath, even his dead body. And he rose from the dead Sunday, that the Bible says was the first day of the week, according to Luke chapter 24 verse 1 to 3. Friends, Saturday is always the Sabbath, the seventh day of the week. Notice, and again, it's always Saturday. And that's why the Bible says the seventh day is the Sabbath. Jewish nation, even though I'm not Jewish, they still keep the Sabbath Saturday. And also, encyclopedia, You will find it even different language. If you speak Spanish, Sábado means Saturday. Friends, this is a beautiful time in history because we only one step away from heaven. The mark of the beast, the worship issue in Revelation chapter 13. If you get time, read it, because Revelation chapter 13 verse 12, it's a worship issue, and verse 15, it's a worship issue, and verse 8 is a worship issue. And the Bible helps us to understand that behind the scene, Revelation 13 is the devil. He wants the whole world to worship him. Friends, you have to escape. You have to study your Bible. Christ is calling you, whether you are Christian or not. Whenever you hear Sunday worship in any countries, do not accept it. God is going to protect you. Bible says our bread and water will be sure. According to Revelation 16, whenever national Sunday law or Sunday law come to history, if you accept Sunday law, you're going to receive the wrath of God that is poured out without mixture. That's why God is warning the whole world right now that we don't have to receive the mark of the beast. Watch this.
Tell us why you're here.
I'm here to sell my soul to the devil. What else? It's Hollywood. I want to be rich. I want to have everything.
My price for selling my soul to the devil is wealth and power.
Infamy.
Fame.
Maybe have my own reality show.
Success in everything I've ever worked for. Absolute respect from people everywhere I go. I think the devil would want my soul mostly because I really am a good person. Satan would like my soul because I, like him, have learned to stand alone and be my own God.
Why would the devil want my soul? I think because I have an innate ability to talk other people into following me down in a handbasket, a path to hell. He might like me because I'm a crowd gatherer.
I'm very entertaining to torture. I'm very entertaining when I'm in pain.
I think Satan would want my soul because the way I learned it in Catholic school is...
You know, selling your soul to the devil is just way too rocking.
About, you know, what was going on in my life at 15, and that's how I got introduced to the music industry. I swear I wanted to be like the Amy Grant of music.
Yeah.
But it didn't work out, and so I sold my soul to the devil.
I sold my soul to the devil. I know it's a crappy deal. Lisa came with a few toys like a Happy Meal.
If I could go back, I never would have rapped. I sold my soul to the devil, I'll never get it back. I just want to leave this game with level head intact. Imagine going from being and knowing to seeing everything blow up, and all you did was just roar up and seeing. It's crazy, cause all I wanted was to get paid.
I want the king to save me. I can't die, my boo-boo's about to have my baby. I think it's too late for Brandon. Hold up, her voice spoke to me and it slowly started saying,
bring your lifestyle to me, you'll make it better.
And how long will I live?
Eternal life and forever.
Oh, will I be the G that I was?
I'm looking like better than you can imagine. I'm dreamed of, so relax your soul. Let me take control. Close your eyes, my soul.
My eyes are closed.
Out here doing these songs, you know, you're still on tour.
I do, but I don't take it for granted.
Why do you still do it? Why are you still out here?
Well, it goes back to the destiny thing. I mean, I made a bargain with it, you know, a long time ago, and I'm holding up my hand.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander
on this earth
and this earth and then in the world we can't see.
My fellow Americans, we will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of Christianity.
Then I met the devil in God's country. It's not so much who, it's what, you know, what happens and the things that the devil does. It's not so much a person, even though he acts through people. This is God's country because I met the devil here. Because if I hadn't met the devil here, I wouldn't realize I was strong enough to overcome the obstacle that the devil would place in my path. And it's by overcoming these obstacles that I realize that this is God's country, because he helped me get over these obstacles. He helped me get over these hurdles.
Okay, so but when you're done,
yeah,
you're out of it.
I'm not looking back.
You're not coming back?
No, I'm not coming back. I'm not coming back for a show. I'm not coming back for a visit. I'm not even driving through the states. If I'm in a plane and they're gonna fly over, I'm gonna go around, okay? I think everyone who's watching knows how I ended up in here.
I don't know if they do.
I'm pretty sure they do. Anytime you get it, I'm pretty sure they do. You know, there's...
What has this done to your career?
What has it done to your career? In what way?
How has it impacted you? Touring, record sales?
My album's number one all over the world. All over the world. America's the only one because... I don't want to say too much.
But it's not number one in the United States.
It's conspiracy, yeah. I don't want to say too much. I'm done. I don't want to say much because I'm hurting. I'm really hurt.
Music that compels me to do it. It's not saying I'm getting ready to grab down there and it's not a great place. You don't think about it. It just happens. Sometimes I look back at the footage and I'll go... And I go, did I do that?
Yeah.
So I'm slave to the rhythm.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm. I think the alarm's going off in the house. I don't know why.
No, she can do things that I cannot do when I'm in rehearsal. I mean, I can try, but then it just doesn't happen. I can sing notes and sing strong and do all these things that when I'm just by myself, I can't do. And I remember right before I performed, I raised my hands up. And it was kind of the first time I felt something else come into me. And I knew that was going to be my coming out night for the BET Awards.
Looking so crazy in love, got me looking so crazy in love.
Where were you, Latoya, when you heard the sad news?
Well, I was actually, my father called me. I was at home, and I had just hung up the phone with my business partner, and he had just told me about Farrah, and I said, "Oh my, geez, I wonder who's next because it always happens in threes." They controlled him. They did what they wanted, and. It was very difficult for him to say no, no, no.
You must have seen this happening. Was there anything that you could do or say to Michael to change that situation?
It's very, very difficult because in situations such as that one, we've tried so many times to intervene. Mm. And it's not always that easy because they keep everybody at bay. They keep everyone away, actually. Mm. Everyone.
How did they do that?
By controlling. And I know because I have been in a controlling and abusive relationship, but by controlling him, controlling his thoughts, control what he does, not letting any, giving orders, not letting anyone through the gates, not letting anyone near security, things of that nature. And this way they have him and they control whatever he does. The phones, no phones in the house.
Mm. Like foul play.
Do you think it's murder?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I said it in the beginning and I believe it to this day.
Latoya, are you going to be attending Dr. Murray's court case?
Absolutely.
What do you think about him delaying everything?
What kind of sentence should you receive, Latoya?
Death penalty. That's what he should be on the arm.
They murdered my brother, and they know who they are. It's not just Dr. Murray, I promise you that. It's more people involved, and they know exactly who they are, and I'm going to let you guys know exactly what's happening and what's going on. It's more than just Dr. Murray that's involved in this.
Will justice be served?
The doctor that you're looking at, the doctor that you see there, was the fall guy. Mm. That's what he was. He was the fall guy.
And so there are people in the background?
There are people in the background.
Pulling strings?
Yes, absolutely. You must remember, Michael told me repeatedly that they were going to kill him, that he was going to die.
Hand over your eyes. Because
I'm a devil worker, what are you talking about? About me, whether it be me being a devil worshiper or whatever, because them reading into my hand over my eye on my album cover.
If your ultimate goal is to be famous, then you're gonna do a lot to get there, like sign your name in blood in a contract with the devil. Like you're gonna end up on a one-way street and it's going nowhere. Like that's just the truth. I've seen so many people like forsake their moral code and their value systems just for a little bit of fame, and it's not worth it at the end of the day. It's really not worth it.
T.B. Joshua would engage all known mind control techniques to keep his disciples in check. Sleep deprivation was his standard, and the cruel punishments he meted out for the slightest offenses were calculated to induce fear. Snitching was the order of the day, and he had the ability to disorientate the best of men. Disciples dared not converse freely for fear of punishment. Gradually, the disciples would be led into working out his deceptions to fool the public, becoming tools in his propaganda machine.
I was made a prophet in June 12, 1999, on his birthday. From then, the powers invested in me increased. I became a terror to co-disciples. People run away from me because I will do whatever he asked me to do. Any disciple he asked me to slap, I will slap.
That the genuine church was also involved in some of the same tricks to a lesser degree. How many more ministers like Chris Oyakhilome did he taint with the spirit of deception?
So now this all-court satanic worshippers singing for the devil by small screen, they use Jesus Christ's name, pretend like they're Christians, says the word of God. They have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof. For search, turn away.
Hey, EBI Shondo, God, we came to praise you. We came to lift you up. We came to magnify your holy name. Hey, EBI Shata, because truly the name of the Lord is a high tower. The righteous run in, and they are saved. Hey, Ibi Ashando, let a spirit of encouragement sweep over your people.
And that's not enough. We got to speak in tongues like the Holy Ghost enforcer.
Savior! Marido! Ishkatai! Yorobobobo Isha! Arobobo Osha! Atayai! Arobo Osha Katai!
What I'm saying is we got to pray.
Roman Catholic papacy occult leaders is spreading Indian's herd that is sacrificed for the devils. Mesh originally came from Indians.
Many have no hesitation in giving the only thing they possess.
Amen. Yeah, not too bad, not too bad, my friend. It's a wonderful day here in Rome. Freezing. But it's beautiful. And yeah, I spoke to the office earlier on. They said there's some hair coming in. Yeah, that's really good, because I think it was in Fiumicino right now, being disinfested. And I think they're delivering it today.
Can you send me an email with the lengths and the number of cartons, please?
All right, so listen, when am I going to see you? When are you coming to Rome? Really? But keep that hair coming, bro. Keep that hair coming. That's it, man. Keep it flowing like the River Nile.
100 kilos of hair, and it cost us about approximately about $100,000.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, great. Man, you work on that immediately and send it back ASAP, as soon as you can. That's right, that's right. You better keep that a secret, yeah? Exactly. All over the world, my friend, all over the world. Listen, I've seen your new prices. Okay, we just have to make some calculations because, of course, the prices are very high. Yeah, no, this is understood. I mean, the quality is undisputable. I mean, we were really, really happy with the quality, so that goes without saying. Because I understand the difficulty in supplying only long hair. Basically, what happens is that the supplier is left with tons of short hair.
Sagita Wadhwani, executive editor of Hello Magazine. Welcome to Young Turks.
Thank you.
Okay, Sagita, 10 years in the business. How's the journey been for you?
Joined with Elle, and it was a very dynamic, very competitive team. Everybody was scrambling to make it, to be the next big editor. And I learned a lot over there. I learned about, it's a women's magazine, and we could read 29 editions from all over the world. The women were changing all over at the same time.
প্রথম আমার শ্বশুর দিল তারপরে এখান থেকে আমার স্বামী দিল তারপরে আমি লাস্টে এবার আমাদের অল্প অল্প লজ্জা করছিল প্রথম প্রথম দিচ্ছিলাম তা
Style can cost up to $4,000, but for stars, it's as fabulous as you can get.
Great lengths are the Rolls Royce of hair extensions. They're the creme de la creme of hair.
Which is why every stunning starlet, from Cameron Diaz to Kate Beckinsale to Celine Dion, is wearing these top tresses. But what makes this hair so great? It's made from uncolored, never treated hair.
And this hair is then collected from these sacred temples in India, shipped off to Hollywood.
Now, a white preacher would say it like this, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. Can I get a witness? That's white preacher. But if I preach at one of the brothers' churches, one of the bishop, and God, I say, the Lord, huh? Oh, you ain't hearing me, believe I'll go over here a while. And the Lord, hey! Hey! Oh, hey! And God is able.
We got a solo lady spinning around. Boom, Usher. Oh, I'm doing my Usher thing right now. Oh, moonwalk on you. Look at this heel toe. I'm a heel toeing for the Crips on the set. Michael Jackson, side to side. This is another Michael Jackson. This dude is going ham. Come on.
Today's Sunday Law News Report features an interesting news item that ought to make you sit up and pay close attention. Now, take a look at this.
The massive encounter with the Pope. The family's coming from five continents for this special pilgrimage and some one-on-one time with the Bishop of Rome himself. This morning, the Pope is once again breaking from tradition. This time at an annual event for families, where 150,000 families from 70 countries join the Pope in Rome to profess their faith. Now, for the first time, hundreds of children and elderly people are standing side by side with the Pope, instead of in the audience, emphasizing the importance of different generations. The Pope saying Saturday,
so many families are there. The Vatican City wants to be known as the capital of the family. The Pope says he'll close out the event, blessing all families around the world. What an event, huh?
Quite an event. You know, it's really interesting. There was a report out this morning that says tourism in Rome has actually gone up this Pope arrived.
His popularity continues to rise.
Amazing.
Great to see you, Gio.
That sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Who doesn't want a social day devoted to families? Who doesn't desire a day where the emphasis is on love for our family and everyone else's? It's a great idea in light of the current attack on traditional family values. But let's take a closer look at this, shall we? When we shine the light of the gospel onto this new satanic effort to recognize Sunday as the day of rest, we'll see that this is just the beginning of persecution for Sabbath keepers. First world meeting of families took place in 1994, and subsequent annual meetings took place in Rio de Janeiro, Rome, Manila, Milan, and again last year in Rome. The Pope has appointed the next Family Day meeting to be held in Philadelphia in 2015. Now, friend, what does all this mean? What is this Family Day all about? The Pope desires that all families have a work-free Sunday. Families should be free from work so that on Sunday, children could be together with their parents and relatives and go to church as well. The Pope also suggests that we should discover the true meaning of Sunday observance on this Family Day.
Primo punto su cui vorrei soffermarmi è questo.
The good news of the family is a very important witness of evangelization, which Christians can communicate to everyone by being witnesses to life. He said the church must give attention and show spiritual closeness.
È fatta di volti.
Now it's interesting that the UN and the Vatican are working together for this Family Day, which will be each and every Sunday. Families will have a rest upon this day, be together with the children and go to church, and so on. Do you see the strategy? The Pope desires to promote Sunday as the day of rest for all families throughout the world. He calls Sunday the Family Day. The previous Pope Benedict said, and I quote, "By defending Sunday, one defends human freedom." Benedict said this during his weekly general audience in St. Peter's Square, just after he had attended a Family Day gathering in Milan, Italy. Pope also said, and I quote, "Sunday must be a day of rest for everyone, so people can be free to be with their families and with God." The Pope clearly stated that he wanted to come to the defense of free time, which is threatened by a kind of bullying, he says, through demands of work. He continued, "Sunday is a day of the Lord and of man, a day which everyone must be able to be free for the family and free for God." This is in the Catholic News Service, June 2012. There it is, friend, straight from the beast himself. Friend, this is so crystal clear. The next step is the enforcement of a Sunday law. Everything else is now in place. Everyone else is on board and now only waiting for life to be breathed into the Sunday law. So when the Pope says that we should have Sunday as a day of rest for the family, he's promoting the counterfeit, unbiblical day of rest. Sunday means the S-U-N day and not the S-O-N day. The test lies before us whether we will worship Him who created heaven and earth and all that is in them, or we will worship the beast and receive his mark. This is dealing with worship, my friend. Whom will you worship and serve? Will you have God as your authority, or will you have the Pope as your authority? Will you be loyal to the Creator, or will you be loyal to people and their laws against God's law? This is the test that lies right before us. May the Holy Spirit help you, and may God help you as you follow Him.
Notice the new world order. It's almost complete.
When our founders declared a new order of the ages, they were acting on an ancient hope that is meant to be fulfilled.
The
Iraq war has been another foreign policy challenge, beginning with John Paul's papacy. Other foreign policy priorities for Benedict include pushing for peace in the Holy Land and decrying rising secularism in Europe. He's also been quietly working to establish relations, something that was not possible during the last papacy, largely because of John Paul's role in the fall of communism in Poland.
The Chinese obviously didn't want John Paul II running around China doing the same thing. Pope Benedict is not that kind of a threat to China. So.
Most of the time in places around the world, Vatican diplomats work outside the spotlight, where experts say they often have an advantage. Some question how much government leaders of today truly listen to what the Pope has to say. And that, observers say, is a moral authority that can't be measured by economic strength or military divisions. A moral authority Benedict hopes to draw upon when meeting with U.S. officials and speaking before the United Nations. I'm Kim Lawton in Washington.
Unfortunate, friends, if you don't understand their final goal, you're gonna be doomed. But the good news is, if you know their final goal, you can escape what's about to happen. Some people will show you some of the secret societies, but unfortunately, they don't tell you the power behind the scene, and the whole world afraid because they don't know what to do. Today, you're gonna find out. Watch the whole video.
At the Vatican today, a warm greeting for President Obama from Pope Benedict XVI.
It's a great honor for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I just got out. Thank you so much for the greeting. New world order is emerging.
When really a new world order can be created, it's a great opportunity.
When all who wear America's uniform remain the cornerstone of our national defense, the anchor of global security. We have to shape an international order that can meet the challenges of our generation. The international order we seek is one that can resolve the challenges of our times.
A new world order is emerging. Gordon Brown's verdict as he closes the G20 summit. From America to Ethiopia, they all signed up to a $1 trillion boost for world trade. We'll have reaction around the world and ask what it means for Britain also tonight.
Before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order.
It is a new world order with significantly different.
Well, there have been extraordinary scenes in Berlin tonight as thousands of people gathered to hear Barack Obama deliver a key foreign policy speech on his current European tour. The Democratic presidential hopeful laid out his vision for America's place in a new world order, saying he was speaking as a proud citizen.
The power behind the scenes secret societies. Notice what is Skull and Bones, Illuminati, Masons, and all them groups. They have one master.
I'm gonna move up a little higher, and I'll
have you ever seen a youth pastor do crazy stuff to get the teens involved? Yo, teens, I'm cool, swag for you. Turn up for the Lord, get ratchet for Jesus. This guy takes that to a whole nother level.
I have repeatedly offered $1,000 to anyone who can prove to me from the Bible alone that I am bound to keep Sunday holy. There is no such law in the Bible. It is a law of the Holy Catholic Church alone. The Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The Catholic Church says, no. By my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep holy the first day of the week. And lo, the entire civilized world bows down in a reverent obedience to the command of the Holy Catholic Church. T. Enright, CSSR, in a lecture at Hartford, Kansas, February 18, 1884. The Catholic Church for over 1,000 years before the existence of a Protestant, by virtue of her divine mission, changed the day from Saturday to Sunday. The Catholic Mirror, September 23, 1893. Question, which is the Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church in the Council of Laodicea, AD 336, transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Peter Geierman, The Convert's Catechism of Catholic Doctrine, 2nd edition, 1910, page 50.
These secret societies, Roman Catholic Church leaders also infiltrate new Organization of Seventh-day Adventists, or SDA, the Selective Message, Volume 1, page 204, Ellen G. White says, the conference churches are new organization. Whenever you get time, read it. So I'm going to give you some of the inspiration that will help you and also will help a lot of Sunday churches that is going to come to the foundation of Adventists. 1 Samuel 16:23, and it came to pass when the evil spirit from God was upon Saul that David took an herb and played with his hand, so Saul was refreshed and was well, and the evil spirit departed from him. Question, if the right kind of music drive up evil spirit, don't you think wrong kind of music could invite evil spirit in? Voice and speech and song, page 420, paragraph 2. This is coming from pen of inspiration. Notice what Ellen G. White says. There is a sound of vocal instrument music. Christians are gathered there. But what is that you hear? It is a song, a flavorous deity fit for dance hall. Amos chapter 5, verse 23. Take thus away from me the noise of the songs, for I will not hear the melody of thy vows. Notice what Ellen G. White says in Selective Messages, Volume 2, page 36, paragraph 2. The things you have described as taking place in Indiana, the Lord has shown me would take place just before the close of probation. Every uncle thing will be demonstrated. There will be a shout of drums, music, and dancing. The senses of rational being will become so confused that they cannot be trusted to make a right decision. And this is called the moving of the Holy Spirit. Selective Messages, Volume 2, page 36 to 37. Notice, continue, notice. The Holy Spirit never reveals itself in such method, in such a bedlam of noise. This is an invention of Satan to cover up his ingenious method for making of non-effect the pure, sincere, elevated, ennoble, sanctifying truth for this time. Better never have the worship of God blended with music, that to use musical instrument to do the work of which last January was presented to me will be brought into our camp meetings. The truth for this time need nothing of said kind in its work of converting soul. A bedlam of noise shock the senses and pervert that which, if conducted all right, might be blessing. The power of satanic agencies blend within the noise to have a carnival, and this is termed the Holy Spirit working. Selective Messages, Volume 2, page 37, paragraph 2. Notice LNG, I continue. No encouragement should be given to this kind of washing. The same kind of influence came in after the passing of that time in 1844. The same kind of representation were made. Men become excited and were working by the power taught to be the power of God. Selective Messages, Volume 2, page 37, paragraph 3, she continued. Notice, I will not go into all the painful history. It is too much. But last January, the Lord showed me that erroneous theories and methods will be brought into our camp meetings, and that the history of the past will be repeated. I have greatly distressed. I was instructed to say that at this demonstration, demons in the form of men are present, working with all the ingenuity that Satan can employ to make the truth disgusting to sensible people, that the enemy will try and arrange matters so that the camp meetings, which has been the means of bringing the truth of the third angel's message before the multitude, should be lost their force and influence. Selective Messages, Volume 2, page 37 to 38. Notice she's continuing. The Holy Spirit has nothing to do with such a confusion of noise and multitude of sounds as passing before me last January. Satan work and make the din and confusion of such music, which properly conducted will be a praise and glory to God. He makes it effect like the poison stings of the serpent. Selective Messages, Volume 2, page 38, paragraph 1. Notice she continues. Those things which has been in the past will be the future. Satan will make music a snare by the way in such it is conducted. God call upon his people who have the light before the man in the word, in the testimonies, to read and consider and take heed. Clear and definite instruction has been given in order that all may understand. By the itching desire to originate something new, result in strange doctrine, and largely destroys the influence of those who will be a power for good if they heard firm the beginning of their confidence in the truth the Lord has given them. Selective Messages, Volume 3, page 332, paragraph 2. Notice what Ellen G. White says. It is not safe for the lost workers to take part in worldly entertainment. Association with worldliness in musical line is looked upon as harmless by some Sabbath keepers, but such ones are on dangerous ground. Thus Satan seeks to lead man and woman astray, and thus he has gained control of souls so smooth, so pleasurable as the working of the enemy, that his wiles are not suspected. And many church members become lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Question: how many culture music does God church have? Answer: Testimonies for the Church, Volume 9, page 181, paragraph 1. Notice what Ellen G. White says. We have not six partners to follow, not five. We have only one, and that is Christ Jesus. If the Italian brethren and French brethren and the Germany brethren try to be like him, they will plant their feet upon the same foundation of truth. The same spirit that dwells in one will dwell in the other. Christ in them, the hope of glory. I warn you, brethren and sisters, not to build up a wall of partition between different nationalities on the country. Seek to break it down wherever it exists. We should endeavor to bring all into the harmony that there's in Jesus, laboring for one object, the salvation of our fellow man. Let me ask you a question. If Jesus and the apostles didn't pray war victory music in the temple of God, how much more people who are living in the time of judgment? Revelation chapter 14 verse 7 says, for the hour of his judgment is come. And we know that according to Revelation chapter 22, the day that Jesus Christ is going to come, he's going to give his reward to everyone according to his work. So the judgment takes place before Jesus Christ comes, because you have to pass the test before you receive your reward. And the book of Hebrews says, Jesus Christ is our high priest. Let me ask you a question. Did the Old Testament church play war victory music in the time of judgment or atonement or at one man or in the tabernacle or the temple of Jewish people? A lot of people says, well, David danced before the Lord. And also Psalm 149 and Psalm 150, the Bible says noise, voices and shout. Music that was playing in the day of David was the battle victory songs and the battle victory music. If you meet a lot of people on the street that they're making a noise, and you ask the question and says, well, why are you guys making a noise? Does anybody win something here? And they say, well, no, they want us. That's why we're making a noise. Does it make sense? New Testament church or the apostle or Jesus Christ time, nobody danced in the church. They was so reverent, so much so that they didn't make a noise in the churches, because the New Testament church understand the Old Testament that a lot of people don't understand in these last days. They understand that our individual victory didn't come yet. According to Revelation chapter 15, verse 1 to 3, God's church, we're not going to have the mark of the beast at the Sunday law. We're going to have the victory over the beast and his image. So at that time, when Jesus Christ appeared after the seven last plagues, we're going to sing music and we're going to shout a victory. We're going to go to heaven, but the victory didn't come yet. Why are you shouting if you're not winning yet? Daniel chapter 3 verse 14 to 18. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, it is true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, not worship the golden image which I have set up? Now ye be ready, that at what time ye heard the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, but if you worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hand? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God we have served is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. He would deliver us out of thy hand, O king. But if not, be known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. God says, I am the Lord, I declare the end from the beginning. Hip-hop, reggae, jazz, blues, and all kinds of sexual, devilish music that is playing in these last days is moving people one step ahead to receive the mark of the beast, that is Sunday law. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11. Notice, all this thing happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wow. Upon whom the ends of the world are come in these last days? Well, you better believe it. They changed our 3-inch logo 1995. They brought this new logo. This is yellow 6-frame all Sinai triangle secret society logo, because they think they're going to overcome 7-day Adventists. But praise the Lord, they cannot overcome those we on the foundation of Adventist. Three angels' messages. Those were building the foundation of many generations, that Isaiah 58 verse 12 and also Jeremiah 6, 16 and 17. Back at chapter 2 verse 1 to 4 and Jude 1 verse 3 says, if you visit every 7-day Adventist and if you don't see this two big chart that you see on the screen, don't go. Come out fast as possible, because you're not going to see Seventh-day Adventist teachers or pastors. Unfortunately, you're going to see ravening wolves, Roman Catholic Church leaders that are preterned that they're Seventh-day Adventists, and they're going to lead you to hell, because the Bible says if a blind leads blind, they both will fall into a ditch. This parable video will blow up your mind, so watch it carefully.
Matthew 13:34 says that Jesus spoke to the multitudes in parables. And
transport a person through time, as in time travel? This is impossible.
No, it is possible, Russell. Traveled over 100 years into the future.
Over 100 years to the 20th... No, the 21st century?
Correct.
You? This is an absurdity.
It is the truth, Russell.
Norris, time travel is impossible. I'm afraid that your illness has affected your judgment more than I thought.
My friend, time travel is possible.
What proof can you provide?
This is why I have arranged a journey for you.
A journey? For me?
Yes. Into the future.
Oh, come now.
Russell, you must see where the teaching of good morals alone will lead. You must see for yourself what happens when we remove the authority of Christ out of life.
I know how this will be taken by you, but I am sure this manner of dress arouses sinful passions in the customers as they walk by.
Sinful passions?
Yes, sinful passions of promiscuity, especially in the younger males. We must be careful as to the example we portray to our young people for the goodness of all society.
Sir, I appreciate you voicing your opinion, and I'll be sure to let my father know, and I want to thank you. But to be honest, this is the first complaint we've had like this. Our customers, most of them don't seem to mind this sort of thing. Okay?
Eddie, I wanted to speak with you again about the importance of attending a local church.
Oh, I go to church, yeah. Christmas, Easter.
Yes, but we need to attend church more than 2 times a year for spiritual growth.
Oh, well, you know, at least I ain't never been to the Slammer.
Slammer?
Yeah, the big house, jail, clink, clink. Man, I thought my English was bad.
But, Eddie, we need consistent Bible study and fellowship if we are to become mature spiritual men.
Shh. Yeah. Jesse Gonzaga just hit a double with 2 men on. We're up 3-2.
Eddie, I'm attempting to talk to you about your spiritual life.
Look, preacher man, with all due respect, I ain't no angel, but I ain't ever cheated or lied or shot anybody. Ask people. Eddie Martinez is a good guy.
Yes, these are all important virtues, Eddie, but it is important that we do more than just not offend each other.
Yeah, we got another run. We're up 4-2. Yeah, you stick around, preacher man. You're good luck.
As a matter of fact, to be perfectly
honest... Oh, baby, you are fine. Hey, look, I'll be off in about a... How about me and you...
Pardon me, sir. You should not be talking to this woman in this manner. What would your wife say?
Wife, I'm not married anymore.
Anymore? Is she deceased?
Deceased? You mean dead? I wish she was. I wouldn't be paying all this alimony. We're divorced.
Divorced? Oh, I'm very sorry.
Sorry? I'm happy. Except for the alimony. She was driving me crazy. People don't understand what I went through with this woman. I mean, dealing with her moods and her demands every day.
But the Lord hates divorce.
Hey, don't be dumping no guilt trip on me, all right? One out of two marriages get divorced these days. It's not like I'm the only one. Besides, it was her fault. She was driving me crazy.
One out of two marriages ends in divorce. This is 50%.
Oh, are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. Would you just trust me? We're going to have the best time. Okay. Well, who's going to get the alcohol? Tommy's older brother.
Young ladies. Excuse me, but I could not help but overhear your conversation, and I am shocked at what you are saying. I could not believe you would want to deceive your parents in this manner.
And who are you, mister?
And you're also speaking of consuming strong alcoholic drink, which should be forbidden, especially for your age.
Right, and so who do you think you are, like our parents or something?
Certainly not, but I am someone who has a genuine concern for your welfare, and I am your elder. We should always conduct ourselves with honesty and integrity.
All right, look, you know what? I am sick and tired of people telling me what I can and cannot do. It's not like we're hurting anyone, so why don't you just chill out?
Scientists are supposed to observe everything they can first, record their observations, and then make public their findings.
You need some help, man? I'd be glad to skip school.
Not at present, but thank you kindly for your offer. May I ask if you're familiar with the works of John Anderson?
John Anderson? I don't believe I've heard of him.
He lived in the late 1800s. Brilliant mind. Published some valuable information on the art of science and experimentation.
We'll have to locate his material.
Yes, please do. His discoveries are fascinating. The best part about Mr. Anderson's work is how he relates everything to the Bible. The scriptures are never wrong.
Mr. Carlyle.
God's holy word is so trustworthy.
Mr. Carlyle.
Yes?
Mr. Carlyle, this is a public school. You can't talk about religion in class.
What is this couple doing?
Hey, what are you doing, mister?
I cannot fathom that this young married couple would kiss in front of a child. What is becoming of them?
They're not married. They're just actors in a show.
Not married?
Come on, mister. Get out of the way.
Movie! You must stop this movie! The man on the screen just blasphemed the name of the Lord! There must be some mistake! You must stop this movie! This is an abomination!
And I just simply mentioned the Bible. I meant no harm by it. And the teacher informed me that she could lose her job over the matter.
Well, our nation is no longer built on the biblical principles set forth by our forefathers. We haven't been able to study the Bible in public school for years. We've lost prayer in school since a Supreme Court decision in what, 1962?
Children not allowed to pray in school? How unthinkable.
Well, we're part of a society that for the most part lives without Christ and His Word.
Last evening, something very shocking occurred. I attended a movie with a group from the church, and the person up on the screen blasphemed the name of the Lord.
Unfortunately, that happens all the time. Oh, I know because I used to be in the film industry.
As a player up there on the screen?
As an actor? No. No, I was a booking agent for a theater chain. I was making all kinds of money, the whole package. But I was miserable inside. Well, I say all of that because when it comes to the film industry, I've been there and I know how powerful and influential it is to society. I believe that secular entertainment is one of the biggest tools that Satan uses to mislead people. He desensitizes us through it. Murder, violence, sexual immorality, you name it. Sin has slowly but surely become acceptable to us because we see it all the time, so it's no longer shocking to us.
But why were these things ever allowed?
Well, frankly, I think that Satan's smarter than we give him credit for. And he's very deceptive. When the movie industry started back in the 30s, it was moralistic for the most part. There was a censor board that regulated what could and could not be shown on the screen, and movie makers were very careful about what they were portraying. And that's when the people didn't realize that the devil won his greatest victory.
His greatest victory? How so?
Because he got the name and the person of Jesus Christ out of the movies. I mean, the morals were there for a while, but the Lord himself was not. And as people became more liberated with their views, there seemed to be less and less conviction, because there was no absolute authority. And that is why people can curse the name of the Lord and they don't even think about it.
But how can these movie makers so mock the Lord? Do they not understand that he is the one who created them and gives them their every breath?
Mr. Carlyle, it says in the Bible that the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. If people don't hold reverence for the Lord, what can we expect?
In the third chapter of Paul's second letter to Timothy, Paul warns us about the last days. In verses 1 through 5, the scriptures say that in the last days, men will be selfish, proud, without natural affection for one another, unthankful, unholy, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. The list goes on. From what I have seen, the state that this society is now in reminds me of the days of Noah just prior to entering the ark, and of Lot and Sodom and Gomorrah. Sin appears to be as blatant and as open now as it was then. Surely these must be the last days that Paul is referring to, and the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is imminent. The Lord God, who created all things, appears to have been eliminated from your schools, your government, businesses, attacked in the arts and in your entertainment. And through these amazing inventions of the radio, television, and the movies, the devil has mightily planted sinful thoughts. I am leaving you now, Eddie.
Okay, preacher, you take care.
I also brought you this.
A Bible, huh?
Yes, God's holy word.
That's all right, preacher. Hey, will you look at this? It's in Spanish.
Please read it, Eddie.
Wow. Yeah, I'll read it.
Yeah, I have your word, Eddie.
If Eddie Martinez tells you he's going to do something, he's going to do something. Now, I'm going to read this.
I believe you, Eddie. May the Lord speak to you.
Yeah, preacher. You're a good egg. Vaya con Dios.
Eddie, there's something I must tell you. Jesus is coming back soon. The requirement, though, to enter this kingdom is that we must be absolutely perfect and without sin.
Well, that leaves me out of that party.
No one is without sin, Eddie. Not one. All of us face eternal judgment and separation from God. This is why we must receive Jesus Christ into our life as Lord. He is the only one who lived a perfect life and thus became the substitute for our sins.
For me too?
Yes, for you too. He rose from the dead, proving he was God, and he wants to save us from the penalty of our sins and give us eternal life. But we must first individually receive him, Eddie. This is what it means to believe in Jesus.
You know, no one ever quite explained it to me like that before.
God wants us to be reconciled to himself, so much so that he gave his only son to die for us. And it's all in this book, Eddie. I pray that you will consider what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Good night, Eddie.
Hey, preacher. Hey, listen, I gotta confess to you something. You know, earlier when I gave you my word that I was gonna read this book, well, I was lying. But that was before. Now I give you my word from my heart that I'm gonna read this book.
God bless you, Eddie.
Génesis. En el principio creó Dios los cielos y la tierra.
Carlisle, in a hurry to go somewhere?
Gentlemen, do not come any closer. You must leave here immediately. There's not much time.
Not much time for what?
I'm afraid I'm not allowed to explain, but you must leave immediately.
Look, we've had enough of your little secrets, Carlisle. I want the truth, and I want it now. Look!
And you've only been gone for a few moments.
Norris, the future. Oh, my heavens, where does one begin? It is incredible. But sin abounds. The Lord is not feared. Morals have replaced Christ, and with liberal teachings. The families are in disarray. No authority, no respect. The world lives without Jesus, while the church seems to be filled with professing Christians who do not follow the Lord they claim to believe.
Yes, it appeared to be this way.
I was wrong in my thinking, very wrong, Norris. To separate the authority of Jesus from his teachings is indeed deadly, as I have just witnessed the end result.
Yes, it would lead many astray.
I'm so sorry I doubted you, my friend. It took great courage to do what you did, and I am forever grateful.
We have been given a great privilege. We must use it for good.
Yes, indeed. Norris, I believe I was witnessing the last days.
Abraham Lincoln said it this way. He says, the best way to destroy your enemy is to make him your friend. At the end of the day, ladies and gentlemen, the enemy only comes to do three things: to steal, kill, and destroy the truth. That's what he's trying to do. So now let's travel back in time 4,000 years and begin to discover where the history of some of these traditions came from. Matter of fact, let's begin in the old-fashioned way. Once upon a time, a long time ago, there lived a man named Nimrod. Nimrod was the great-grandson of Noah. He was the most popular man on the earth at the time. Matter of fact, he was the king of the then known world. He was responsible for building the cities of Babel and the Tower of Babel and the city of Nineveh, amongst others. He created great armies right after the flood. He was full of idolatry and covetousness, drunkenness, and a rebelliousness towards God. But Nimrod married a woman named Semiramis. Now Semiramis and Nimrod would became basically king and queen of the then known world. Well, at some point, Nimrod dies, and he became deified. He was the very first person that was ever deified on planet Earth, and they made him the sun god, which ended up being Baal. The word Baal in your scriptures can be traced back to Nimrod. So it's an interesting reality of history. When you see Baal and Ashtaroth, you're ended up coming all the way back to this story of Nimrod and Semiramis. Semiramis gets pregnant by Nimrod, and she gives birth to a young baby boy named Tammuz. Now, further down in the story, as Tammuz grows and becomes a man, Tammuz actually marries his mother, and they have a very sexual relationship. And that baby Tammuz and his mother Semiramis is where you get the story of Cupid. Cupid, during Valentine's Day, is how the story of Valentine's Day developed, was from Tammuz, who married a very unbiblical relationship with his mother. Okay, back to the story of Tammuz. So Tammuz, for 40 years, was a tremendous hunter, and he took the place of his father ruling the world and had tremendous power. But more than anything, he was a credible hunter. But unfortunately, his gift and his skill of hunting caught up with him one day, because he was killed during his 40th year by a wild boar. Every spring, the first Sunday after the vernal equinox, the spring equinox, they had what was called Ishtar's Sunday. And they would have a sunrise service. At the sunrise service, the priest of Ishtar would impregnate young virgins on the altar. And during that same service, they would take the babies that were now 3 months old from the previous year, and they would sacrifice those children on the altar to Ishtar. And then they would take the eggs of Ishtar, and they would dip those eggs in the blood of those young infants. And that is where we get sunrise services, and that is potentially where we get the dying of Easter eggs. It is also interesting to note that worldwide, universal color of Easter eggs is red. Even the White House, the official color of the White House Easter egg is ruby red. Now, back to Tammuz. Tammuz gets killed by a wild boar. So every year in commemoration of celebrating the death and the deification of Tammuz, which became the son of God, the son of his father, they would set aside 40 days prior to Easter, and they would fast and they would pray, and they would have a giant feast on Easter Sunday where they would celebrate the death and the resurrection of Tammuz. And guess what they would have for dinner on that Sunday evening? You got it, Easter ham. They would kill a boar in commemoration to Tammuz, who was killed by a wild boar. And yes, the 40 days prior to Easter, we call it Lent, or the Catholics call it Lent, that 40 days did not come from, my friends, the 40 days of Jesus in the wilderness. That 40 days was already in place for thousands of years before Jesus even showed up. It comes from the 40 days of fasting and praying for Tammuz before they celebrated Easter. I'm going to give you some of the names and what they're most commonly remembered for in these different cultures, and some of you will recognize them immediately. First of all, in Egypt, they were known as Isis and Osiris. In Phoenicia, they were recognized as Asheroth and Baal, the very same Asheroth and Baal that you see in the scriptures. In Greece, they were Aphrodite and Adonis, or Eros, where we get the word erotic from. And in Rome, they were called Venus and Cupid. That's right, that's where we get Valentine's Day from, and Cupid. Even in the Far East, listen to this, this is amazing, Cupid was known as Zoroaster. Zoroaster is made up of two words, Zoro, which means seed of, and Asheroth, which is Easter. And so what Cupid actually means in the Far East is the seed of Easter, or the seed of his mother. Okay. God always tries to speak to the Israelites and warn them to stay away from Asheroth and Baal. Let's read the scriptures. Judges chapter 2, verse 13 says this, "And they forsook Yahweh and served Baal and Asheroth." 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 4 says, "Then the children of Israel did put away Baalim and Asheroth and served Yahweh only." And last but not least, in Romans chapter 11, verse 4, it says, "But what says the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal." Right about this time, you're probably having that thought that I warned you about hit your brain, saying, that's not what it means to me. I celebrate the birth of Jesus, and I put all the focus on Jesus, and I celebrate his resurrection, and I want to focus on him. Well, your heart may be to want to focus on him, and you absolutely may do that. But the truth of the matter is that it doesn't matter how much we focus, how sincere we are, and how pure our hearts are. It only matters that are we worshiping him the way that he asks us to worship him, and is anything that we're doing offending him? Please keep an open mind as we move through the rest of this history and some of these symbols, which are very shocking, that you're going to find out how they moved through time and ended up in our Christian churches today. Tammuz and his mother, Semiramis. If you look on your screen, you're going to see Isis and Osiris, or this is Ishtar and Tammuz. Now, some of you may be asking, well, wait a minute, I celebrate Easter, you're talking about Ishtar. Easter is actually the Anglicization of the word Ishtar. In other words, if you say Ishtar in English, it's pronounced Easter. That's how the etymology of that word evolved over time. What I want you to see is I want you to see what's on her head is a crescent moon, and in the center of that crescent moon is the actual sun itself. And so the symbol of power of Isis or Ishtar was the crescent moon holding the sun itself, her deceased husband, Baal, the sun god. And you can see the baby there that is nursing from her breast. Ishtar was known as the goddess of the East, the bare-breasted fertility god of the East, or the sunrise, which is why they had the service at sunrise on Easter morning. Here on your screen, you see a pagan carving of the solar deity Baal Hadad, depicted as a disc in a crescent. Okay, you can see the half-moon disc there in the center of your screen with the sun that is cradled inside of it. And that is the sun god, as well as the crescent moon that surrounds it. Catholic Eucharist is actually the sun that is inside of that crescent moon, or not. Now, look very carefully at, on the right-hand side, you can see the moon, the crescent moon shaped, holding that sun or that wafer of bread. Here's a close-up of it right here. The crescent moon cradle with the sun-shaped monstrance of the Roman Catholic Church, thousands of years old. This comes right out of paganism and sun god worship, where it was the symbol of Baal and his wife, Ishtar. Let's move on to another symbol. This is the symbol of the trident. The trident is the devil's pitchfork. It really is a symbol of Satan, of the horns of Satan. It's an ancient satanic and pagan hand gesture called the trident. The most famous one, of course, is Neptune's trident. We call it the devil's pitchfork, and that's where it comes from. It's just not a drawing that someone made up. This has history built into it of where these things come from. This is a pagan statue of Jupiter that has been renamed Saint Peter. And he's holding up, guess what? The trident symbol. That symbol is a satanic symbol recognizing the power of the gods of the sun. You also see what is baby Jesus, supposed to be baby Jesus, is none other than baby Tammuz. And how do we know it's not Jesus? Because you see trident all over the place. You see the trident symbol in the hand of the infant Jesus, along with the tridents coming out of the statue's head. You'll see three tridents, two coming off the sides of the head and one coming off the top of the head. This is not baby Jesus, ladies and gentlemen. This is a pagan sun god, Tammuz, from the story of Baal, Nimrod, and Semiramis, ended up being Cupid in today's Valentine's Day. Even the Sacred Heart comes right out of paganism. That exact same symbol with the sun disk behind the Sacred Heart has to do with Baal and Tammuz, the sun gods. And you can see it all over the Roman Catholic Church and even in other pagan religions across the world. And where do we find this eight-pointed star, this solar wheel, this sun disk today? None other than on top of our Christmas trees. Now, I know all of us have been taught that the star on top of the Christmas tree represents the Star of Bethlehem, that the kings came in to find baby Jesus. But unfortunately, the star of the ancient pagan sun gods predates the star of the Christmas tree, the Star of Bethlehem, by over 1,000 years. They were taking the sunburst and connecting it to what you're going to learn in just a few minutes is the tree of Nimrod. And that is where we get our Christmas tree from and the star that we put on top. If you look carefully, you can see there is a tremendous significance and a similarity between the sunburst and the star that we put up there today. Here's the sun disk proudly displayed on top of Christmas trees in a mall. Matter of fact, this one doesn't even hide the fact that it's not a star, it's the sun. In the middle of the winter, at this winter solstice, December 25th. That's right. That's where we get December 25th on Christmas Day, where we say that Jesus was born. Why did we choose Jesus being born on December 25th? Where did that date come from? Very simple. Jesus was the Son of God. Tammuz was the son of the gods. He was the son of his father, Baal. And so the pagans, which early Christianity came right out of paganism in Rome, they were already worshiping the sun god on Sunday in Rome, which is where we get worshiping on Sunday from. It used to be that all of the early Christians worshipped on Saturday, but it was changed to Sunday because all of the pagans worshipped the sun god on his day, Sunday, and they worshipped him on his birthday on December 25th. So naturally, when Jesus came into the picture and Constantine supposedly got saved in the 300s, they compromised to make it easier for people to convert to Christianity by making Jesus' birthday on the same birthday as the sun gods that they were already used to celebrating. And that's where we get December 25th from. And so what we're going to show you right now is an actual clip or a short movie of a montage of different videos that we've discovered of where they still make this celebration, still celebrate this, all around the world, where they literally glorify the demonic part of Christmas and St. Nicholas and these dark helpers. There are some scholars that believe that the actual song Jingle Bells came from the Krampus bells that were in existence for a long time before that song was ever written, that every time you saw St. Nicholas, he was accompanied by the bells of Christmas, if you will, from his elves. They used to have bells that would hang from their necks, and as you heard in the video, they would you would hear the bells as they announced themselves into the next town that they were going into. Clear indication of whether or not we can do things just because we are sincere about it. Deuteronomy chapter 12 says this, "And you shall destroy their altars, break their sacred pillars, their obelisk, burn their wooden images with fire. You shall cut down the carved images of their gods and destroy their names from that place. You shall not worship the Lord your God with such things." He says, you shall not at all do as we are doing here today, every man doing whatever's right in our own eyes. Some of the most influential Christian leaders in American history were looking for alternatives and refused to celebrate Christmas and Easter because of their pagan backgrounds. Charles Spurgeon said this, on December 24th, Christmas Eve, 1871, look at this quote, "We have no superstitious regard for times and seasons. Certainly we do not believe in the present ecclesiastical arrangement called Christmas. First, because we do not believe in the Mass at all, but abhor, whether it be said or sung in Latin or English." He went on to say, "And secondly, because we find no scriptural warrant whatsoever for observing any day as the birthday of our Savior. And consequently, its observance is a superstition because it's not of divine authority." Ladies and gentlemen, this is one of the most spiritually held up pastors of all time, is Charles Spurgeon. And he himself says Christmas is of no divine origin, it's of no divine authority, and we absolutely should not celebrate it. Why? Because he knew that its origins were in paganism and cultic philosophy. We have, what did all of the disciples do in the spring that just so happens to be the time of Easter? Absolutely, it's called Passover. Luke 22:19 says this, "And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Do Passover." Obviously, Easter was nowhere in the minds of our Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua the Messiah, or his disciples, or anybody for hundreds of years. They celebrated what's in Hebrew called Pesach, Passover, every single year, remembering the death, burial, and resurrection of their Lord through that incredible holiday where they used to sacrifice a Passover lamb for the remembrance of the death of the firstborn and the freedom from Egypt. But now today, they were remembering the freedom from sin, freedom from Egypt, being metaphorical, by the death of Jesus himself. So they would never have connected Easter with Passover. It didn't exist. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul even instructs us in verse 8. "Therefore, let us keep the festival," talking about Passover, "not with the old yeast, the yeast of malice and wickedness, but with the bread without yeast, the bread of sincerity and truth."
If you want to watch a lot of present true videos that will prepare you in these last days, visit the7thunders.com. You can download a lot of videos or audios for free and watch them and share them with everybody that you can. Spread this video fast as possible on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, every website and every place that you can.
Spread the word, Jesus Christ is coming. Spread the word, the Sunday law is near. Go and tell the Revelation story as the fire in the wind burning up the field. There's the devil coming as an angel of light, trying to change God's law. The prisons and the mountains will see the sign of God's protecting arm, the face of Jesus. Spread the word, soon probation's closing. Cling to Him, rest in Him, Jesus, Prince of Peace.